أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. ربنا وابعث فيهم رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياتك ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة ويزكيهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ثم أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. We're reading from the 129th ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, in which the dua of Ibrahim عليه السلام is completed. He says, ربنا, our Lord, وابعث, our Master, وابعث فيهم, and additionally appoint among them, raise from among them. بعث in Arabic is an interesting word. It's used for appointing someone and also to elevate someone. So it does two things at the same time. One, there's ta'yin in it, like عينا we say nowadays in Arabic, or ميزة even, to distinguish someone in Arabic, to appoint someone, but at the same time to give them a higher status than the ones he was picked from. So he was from among the ummiyin, but because of the use of the word ba'atha, it is already implied that the one who will be chosen by Allah will have a higher status. Like Allah highlights, for example, the status of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, despite the fact that he's from among the Arabs and among the Sahaba. وَعْلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Know that even amongst you, even though he's amongst you, it is the Messenger of Allah. There is a difference, right? So that's implicated or implied inside the word ba'atha. بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ, appoint from among them. Also understand, among them is important. And then it's reiterated again, رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. So appoint among them a messenger who is from them. Now appointing in their midst a messenger, by that alone in the language, could imply that the messenger will be from outside, but will be living in them, and within them he was picked. But then he iterates, مِّنْهُمْ, on top of that, he should be from them. The messenger should be from them. And here we learn something very very subtle about the methodology of da'wah. That if you look at the da'wah of the messengers, with very few exception, you'll find that the primary audience of all prophets were their own people. They were their own people. And part of the legitimacy of accepting the call of a messenger was, this is our own, this is from our own people, right? And it's interesting, inshallah, at another opportunity, perhaps in the Madani surahs we'll discuss this in more detail, but you'll find even the Sahaba and them being proactive when it comes to giving da'wah, it was different when they were among their own people, and it was different when they went to different tribes. Like their methodology differed. So for instance, when you find the Muslims in Habasha, and the way they carried themselves is very different than how the Muslims carried themselves in Mecca. Because now they're among a people that are not of their own, as opposed to the Sahaba in Mecca are among the people that are of their own. And the effectiveness, even though we're not going to talk about the strategy aspect of it yet, but the effectiveness of it at least. How much of a bigger impact does it have that your own people call you to something as opposed to an outsider? I mean, think of it even from our contemporary point of view. Some of the most powerful da'is we have to Islam in this country are people that came to Islam, and when people look at them, they don't see Pakistani, they don't see Egyptian, they don't see Bangladeshi, they don't see Turkish, they don't see Indonesian. What do they see first? American, right? Those are some of the most powerful da'is we have. Even if you don't agree with the religious aspect of it, if you look at it just point blank strategically, you'll see there's a huge difference. When somebody on the outside tries to tell you something, there are two barriers now. The first barrier is the message itself. This is an alien message to me. Why should I change everything about my life? On top of that, now there's another psychological barrier. You're from the outside. You're going to tell me how to live. It's like you're saying your people are better than mine. So there's another barrier placed. But when it's a person from within your ranks, at least one of those barriers is dropped. So it's part of the genius of Ibrahim alayhi salam that he asked that a messenger that comes should be from among them. Rasulam minhum. Then he says, what should he do? يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. He will read onto them. He will tala yatlu. Tilawa in Arabic comes in two meanings, to read and to follow. I mentioned this to you before. Right? يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. He will read onto them your miraculous signs. He will read your revelations onto them. And yatlu is important here because if he's reading, when you read something, then it's different from speaking. Right now, as I'm talking to you right now, I am speaking. But when I say يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ, I'm reading from the Mus'haf. Those are not my words, those are the words of the Mus'haf. Describing the Prophet, Allah Azza wa Jal, or Ibrahim alayhi salam asked Allah, he should be someone who doesn't say what you want, he reads your ayat onto the people. In other words, the words he says aren't his own. They are being given to him. Revelation is being given to him. That's embedded inside these words, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ. Then he says, وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ, and he will teach them the book. And the book also in Arabic, in classical Arabic, implies the law. He will teach them the book, also means he will teach them the law. And the word يُعَلِّمُ is important too. Because عَلَّمَ يُعَلِّمُ in Arabic means something that takes time to learn. Teaching that takes time. It's not done just, here you go, this is haram, done. It's not like that. That's إخبار in Arabic. أخبرَ عَنْ شَيْءٍ, inform, or أعلم even, to inform somebody of something immediately, that's something else. So the Messenger's job is not just to inform people of what the law is, of what Allah's law is, but to teach them. Now in teaching, you have to say it, then you have to review it, then you have to test it. You know, you have to take time, and it takes time to sink. So he's being sent as a teacher of law, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which means there's this tarbiyah aspect of it embedded inside the ayah. You know, he didn't just say, you know, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكَ وَكِتَابَكَ. He'll read onto the people your ayat, and he will read your book, and that, your laws, and that's it, he's done. No, he'll teach the laws. Reading the ayat versus teaching the laws, and we'll talk about that a little bit in a second, and the differences between them. And he will also teach them, وَيُعَلِّمُهُمْ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ, which implies, وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْحِكْمَةَ. He'll teach them wisdom. Here we learn also, wisdom is not something you can just tell someone. When we think of a wise anecdote, right, it's some wise saying you may hear, and you say, oh, that's pretty deep. But you heard it, but you didn't learn it. Learning wisdom means that you not only remember it, but you learn to, you live by it. Now you've learned it. It takes time to, you know, learn wisdom. It doesn't come, you know, quickly. So يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ, and finally, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ, and he will cleanse them. He'll purify them. زَكَّى يُزَكِّي, تَزْكِيَة is to cleanse, to purify, to remove impurities. Now, we have to talk about a few things here. First, the difference between يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكْ and وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِكْ, such a beautiful logical progression, when he reads the ayat onto people. When he reads the ayat onto people. What this implies is, we talked about this on Sunday, proliferation. He's just reading the ayat, he's spreading the message. And the ayat are getting far and wide. But when some people hear the ayat, some of them are drawn to this message. And they come closer to the Prophet ﷺ. And those who come closer to him become his students. And this, when they become students, he becomes the what? He becomes the teacher. So يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. يُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ. And of course, when you learn for a long time, that is when you start seeing what? Wisdom. Wisdom doesn't come first. You may learn in the beginning, and later on you may see the wisdom in things. So this happens in any field, by the way. Those who are experienced in a particular field, they have a lot more wisdom in that field than someone who's read a lot more books than them. Right? There's book knowledge and then there's wisdom. Wisdom is a combination of book knowledge and experience. Right? So it comes a little later. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. And finally he adds one more thing. As though teaching or educating is not enough, he will also cleanse them, he'll purify them. This purification, I've also mentioned to you, tazkiyah before, is made up of two things. There's an intellectual cleansing, and there's a character cleansing. You can even call it a spiritual cleansing. The intellectual cleansing is you have false ideas. You believe in the wrong things. You have your own idea of what it means to be good or what it means to be bad, what to believe and what not to believe. He cleanses all that filth out and replaces it with truth. That's one. Second is our character has filth. Not just the ideas can have impurities, our character can have impurities. The way you carry yourself, the way you speak, the way you do business, the way you deal with your family, the way you dress, the way you talk, the way you walk, the way you spend your time, all of these can be dirty. And so he comes, not only does he educate and tell people about the ayat, he is in the process of cleansing people also. He purifies them. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. What an ingenious dua that Ibrahim alayhi salam made, asking for these very particular four things that a prophet will do. Then he says, إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Certainly you're the ultimate authority and you're the all-wise. You are capable of doing that. You're the authority. I'm not saying you have to do it. I'm leaving that authority with you. Allah Azza wa Jal. What's interesting about this ayah is that it's mentioned twice more in the Qur'an. Similar syntax is mentioned twice more. Once in Ali Imran and once in Surah Al-Jumu'ah. And the other two times that it's mentioned, the sequence is altered. The sequence is not the same. Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Ali Imran, he says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ. So Allah did a favor upon the believers when He raised among them a messenger from among themselves that's similar to this one. Then He says, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ. He reads onto them His ayat. That's similar to this one, right? Then He says, وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. And He purifies them. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. And He teaches them the book and the wisdom. So is it exactly the same or no? There is some difference. Did you notice what difference there was? That the purification, instead of getting mentioned at the end, now it's mentioned second. Here what was mentioned was, first He teaches the ayat, or He reads the ayat on the people, He teaches the book and the wisdom, and finally purification is mentioned. There the sequence is altered. Then you look at Surah Al-Jumu'ah. In Surah Al-Jumu'ah, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Allah is the one who appointed. He's the one who appointed among the unlettered a messenger from among themselves who reads his ayat onto them. He purifies them. He teaches them the book and the wisdom. Once again, a different sequence. So the first observation I want you to make is that when Ibrahim alayhi salam is speaking, the sequence is something else. The other two times, Allah is speaking, and the sequence is something else. So the two times that Allah speaks, the sequence is different. The one time that Ibrahim alayhi salam speaks, the sequence is different. The one we're studying right now is which one? Who's speaking in this one? It's Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is the one Ibrahim alayhi salam is speaking. Now, understand what's coming before. What's coming before is Ibrahim alayhi salam. If you've been keeping up with the past few weeks, Ibrahim alayhi salam makes dua. Allah says, no, وَمَنْ كَفَرَ فَأُمَتِّعُهُ قَلِيلًا. Ibrahim alayhi salam says, only feed my believing children. No, not your children. First he said, وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي. What about all my kids? He said, لَا يَنَلُوا عَهْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ. Right? Now the du'as are progressing. And finally, there's this dua. In the passage of Baqarah, this is the last dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And after this dua, you don't find a response from Allah. What does that mean? Every other dua had a rebuttal, had a response. But this dua, these last two duas, رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْنَا مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكْ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكْ وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. And then this dua also, at the end of it, there's no response from Allah, which means it is accepted. But Allah did one more than accept. Allah didn't just accept, He perfected the dua. Ibrahim alayhi salam, as much knowledge as he has as a messenger, made the best dua he possibly could as a human being. But Allah Azza wa Jal, in His wisdom, knew even better that the future generations that are coming, when they hear the ayat, before they are ready to learn, they will need to be what? They'll need to be cleansed. They will need to be cleansed. Ibrahim alayhi salam has what experience with children? What kind of children does he have immediately? Prophets, great kids. So even though tazkiyah, purification, is on his mind, where is it in the list of things? It's at the end. By the time this last prophet rolls around, what do you think? Tazkiyah is going to be a bigger item on the agenda or no? This purification? Allah knew what is coming in the future. What kind of people the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will have to deal with, and what they will need first before they move on. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابُ وَالْحِكْمَةُ. And we learned the Allah perfecting the kalam of Ibrahim alayhi salam and taking it to what a human being cannot take it to, as incredible as his dua was. Then on top of that, you find that Allah reminds us, even in those other ayat, that it is a fulfillment of Ibrahim's dua. It is in fact a fulfillment of Ibrahim's dua. Not just because the language is similar, because Allah takes other aspects, other wordings of Ibrahim alayhi salam's dua, and He puts it back in those same ayat. Because he said, رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. رَبَّنَا وَبْعَثْ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. Appoint a messenger from among them. Then he made the dua. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِّنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Did you repeat Ibrahim alayhi salam's words? He appointed a messenger from among themselves, their own selves. هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ. He's the one who appointed among the unlettered a messenger among themselves. He repeated the words that Ibrahim alayhi salam had uttered, just to make us clear that this is a fulfillment. The messenger coming and doing these four things is a fulfillment of the mission, or actually the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam.
From it, we learn the power of dua. One of the things Mufassirun talk about that baffles them is one can never appreciate the power of dua, because it is a dua, it is a fulfillment of a dua that brings down the final revelation and the final messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The messenger of Allah is the result of a dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Can you imagine the power of dua? Right? Well, if you think about it in that sense. You know, you can say, I want to ask Allah for a lot of things, but what I'm asking for might be too big. Well, I don't know if it can be any bigger than the revelation of Quran and the sending of Allah's final messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That happens as a result of sincere dua. Then also in ta'thir of dua, when are they making this dua? They were making this dua when they were building Allah's house. إِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَعِيلِ. As they were building Allah's house, they were making this dua. So when we are doing things to build Allah's deen, and I use the verb on purpose. You know, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he talked about the deen, one of the most famous hadith in Islam that probably all of you know, at least the first parts of it, بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسٍ. بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسٍ. What does that mean? Anyone know? Islam is built upon five things. Bunya in Arabic, from binaya, to construct. Even in that hadith, there is imagery of construction. Islam is built on five things. And by saying that, what Allah's Messenger is saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is that the five things are the foundation, then you build on top of that. The five things are not Islam. Islam is built on them. It's built on them. Bunya al-Islamu ala khams. So, like the house of Allah is part of building the deen, there are all different kinds of projects, all different kinds of works that are part of helping Allah's deen, that are part of making the light of Allah's deen complete. And in all of them, when we're making those projects, when we're doing things for the sake of Allah, those are awesome times to be making dua. Those are great times to be asking Allah Azza wa Jal. This ayah is extremely deep, so I'll take a couple more minutes inshallah ta'ala and mention just a few more things about this beautiful, beautiful utterance. In this ayah, there is a piecemeal or a bit by bit depiction of a methodology. The methodology of the work of a messenger. And so every time a person wants to do the work of the messengers, alayhi salatu wasalam, then they should understand this methodology. What is it that is required of people? What is the great, you know, the practice by which the messenger achieved his success, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, which Allah calls a favor on the believers? Yatlu alayhim ayatihi is mentioned number one. He reads unto the people the ayat. So as a community within ourselves and even outside of ourselves, one of our first projects is what? Is reading Qur'an. Reading Qur'an not just to yourself, but to others. Not just reciting it and memorizing it and reciting it properly with tajweed, that's there too. But yattu alayhim ayatihi also implies that we educate people about what the book says. He educates people about what the book says. And Allah said about those people, al-ummiyin, they're unlettered. They don't know. And nowadays most people are lettered in many things, but they're not lettered in what? In Allah's book. We're ummi in a new sense. We're ummi in a new sense. That's, you know, nowadays people know, I say this all the time, right? People know, like, not even human languages. They can read like 8 pages of code and know where to put a semicolon in C++ or whatever developer language they know. They don't even know human languages. They can process that, but when it comes to Quran, they don't know. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِي. This is a project. Umar bin al-Khattab, in his rule, one of the first projects he took over was, he would make sure every few circle of Sahaba have their own halaqah of Qur'an. They're studying Qur'an together. This is one of his projects. So this is something we have to do. يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ. And then, if you look at, inshallah, the benefits of that sequence when we get to those ayat, but at least for now in this sequence, we use zakkihim. Tazkiyah is a project. Tazkiyah is at the end here. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةِ. He teaches them the book. The book implies the Qur'an, but it's beyond just reading it. Reading it is like I'm doing right now. I'm not teaching, I'm reading it. But teaching it means you gotta sit down in a class, you gotta, you know, apply effort, and you gotta learn, and you gotta be tested, and you have to kind of have somebody looking over you. We have to be in the process of learning, proper learning. إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ. The Messenger says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا الْعِلْمُ بِالتَّعَلُّمُ means knowledge only comes with serious effort in trying to acquire knowledge. In other words, with just sitting there, you know, sitting back and hitting play on a YouTube video, that's not an acquisition of knowledge. There's no ta'allum there. There's mushahada. You watched it, or you heard it in the car. That's great. That's still in the yatlu alayhi mayati. He's reading it on to them. That doesn't mean they learned it yet. Learning is a separate process. وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابِ Which means not only do we have to have these da'wah kinds of affairs, we also have to have what? Educational types of affairs. We have to have an educational setting in which we're properly learning the book. وَالْحِكْمَةَ And here, al-kitaba wal-hikmah, you know, there are different opinions of the ulama. We should know that they're not qat'i. Like for example, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i's opinion, Imam Malik more famously said that al-kitab is the Qur'an, al-hikmah is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those opinions are awesome, but we shouldn't consider them qat'i. In other words, it's not absolute evidence on the Qur'an that kitab means book and hikmah means sunnah. Right? Other ulama said, no, actually all four of these things is referring to the Qur'an. The kitab is clearly the Qur'an. The ayat are clearly the Qur'an. Wisdom, Allah calls it, you know, وَالْقُرْآنِ الْحَكِيمِ The Qur'an full of wisdom. And He purifies them with what? So they said this last why is, you know, عَطَفْ بَيَانِ As a result of doing these things, He's purifying people. As a result of this process, they're being purified, they're being cleansed. That they are listening to the ayat, they're listening to the reminder, they're learning it, and they're acquiring wisdom over time. And in that process, they are becoming people that are purified. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ Certainly, you're the ultimate authority, the all-wise. What an amazing project laid out for a community. At the level of children, at the level of women, at the level of men, college students, high school students, summer programs, Sunday programs, all these projects that we're doing, they should be inspired by a vision to emulate, to do something from that layout, that blueprint, that was laid down by Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam through the revelation that Allah gave him. These beautiful words. And it works so well that Ibrahim alayhi salam thought of it and then Allah perfected it on top of that. So it works. It's not like a failing plan. It's not just theory. If you apply it, you will find the final result. The final result in Ibrahim alayhi salam's concern was tazkiyah, was cleansing. Because he knew the only people that Allah would punish are people that are not cleansed, the people that are not clean. So he looked at that as the ultimate goal, and in one sense that is an ultimate goal. That is a final goal that we should aspire towards. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us people who are able to benefit from the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam and are able to implement these things in our personal lives and even as our lives in our lives as a community. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ومن يرغب عن ملة إبراهيم إلا من سفه نفسه ولقد اصطفيناه في الدنيا وإنه في الآخرة لمن الصالحين إذ قال له ربه أسلم قال أسلمت لرب العالمين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى اله وصحبه ومن والاه ثم ما بعد We're continuing our discussions on Surah Al-Baqarah. We've reached ayah number 130. This ayah appears right after the ayah in which Allah mentions his fulfillment of the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, where he sent his final messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even though Ibrahim alayhi salam was not explicitly mentioned in the previous ayah, we all know that the dua was made previously already. This was actually the dua. So now Allah says, this is the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And He makes a really emphatic call for us to be committed to that legacy. And He says, وَمَنْ يَرْغَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ إِبْرَاهِيمِ Who would turn away from the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam? Who would incline away from it? The Arabic word رَغِبَ comes with two prepositions. It can come with رَغِبَ إِلَى or رَغِبَ عَنْ. When you're inclined to something, would you really like to do something? Then it comes with إِلَى, the preposition إِلَى, to be inclined to it. رَغِبَ عَنْ, the preposition عَنْ implies when you're disgusted by something, you want to get away from something, you're turned away from it. So here the عَنْ implies what kind of person would turn away from the مِلَّة. مِلَّة implies nation but also means legacy. So the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam, إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِهَ نَفْسَهُ Except for the one who's fooling himself. Except for the person who's fooling himself. Now it's interesting, this is the second time foolishness is being mentioned in the surah. And it's going to come a third time too. The first time we came into contact with this term was when the hypocrites were talking about the believers who have made hijrah from Mecca. And they've left everything behind. And they were called fools. And now the one who doesn't abide by the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah is calling him a fool. And interestingly, there is a parallel between these two things, because Ibrahim alayhi salam, if you study his legacy, you find something very interesting and very, very peculiar. Ibrahim alayhi salam is, you know, they call him the father of the three religions, and this kind of interfaith terminology is used. All three religions, you know, Islam, Christianity, and Judaism have high regard for Ibrahim alayhi salam. But in agnostic circles and in circles that basically make fun of religion, one of the most entertaining points for them is the life of Abraham. Like, that's the point of ridicule in their circles. And I'm glad that you don't know much about those circles, but I happen to. And the reason they make fun of them is they say, what kind of God makes a man, you know, try to sacrifice his own kid? And what kind of God makes a man jump into the fire? And et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So they look at all the things that Ibrahim alayhi salam did that when we look at them, we say, that's incredible. We take, you know, we admire the commitment of Ibrahim alayhi salam, how he submitted before Allah. Those are the very things the outsider looks at and says, what kind of foolishness is this? What kind of religion would make a person do that? You really want to follow that kind of religion? And now Allah is giving us our attitude, the wiring of our attitude. He says, who would turn away from this legacy except an idiot? You're calling this stupid? No, actually. Who would turn away from this legacy? إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِيهَا نَفْسَهُ. Except the one who's fooling himself. Truly fooling himself. SubhanAllah. How the way we think is changed. And you know, the other thing, I've had my share of conversations with like agnosts and so-called atheists and things, positive and negative atheists, they call them. Positive atheists are agnosts, or actually actual atheists. Negative atheists are, I'm not sure if I'm atheist either. Maybe there's a God, maybe there isn't a God. The other word for that is agnost, right? So in my conversation with them, they say about Ibrahim alayhi salam, they say, well, he was commanded to slaughter his kid. So what, are you guys going to do that too? Because he did it, and you want to be like him. And that's, you know, an average Muslim, if they don't know how they make these kinds of arguments to try to catch you, you might not see what they're trying to do. Look, when Allah gives instructions directly to a messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, whoever he may have been, those are particular instructions for him. And unless that messenger leaves you with instructions to do the same, or in his lifetime he makes sure that you imitated what he was doing, then those instructions don't apply to you. They're for him specifically. They're for him especially. So in the case of our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there are instructions that are very particular to him. And then in the Quran also, there are instructions that are very particular to him. And then there are instructions that apply to everybody else. For example, Qiyamul Layl, the standing in the middle of the night, which is an option for us, was made mandatory upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The ayat of ahkam came on the messenger in Surah Muzammil, Surah Al-Mudathir. You find those ayat in which he had to make qiyam, but that he made it an option upon us. And at the end of the surah, Allah even, you know, relaxed the obligation upon us, but not on his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the same thing is the case with Ibrahim alayhi salam. He's being tested with something the rest of us aren't being tested with. It's something special that Ibrahim alayhi salam was given. Anyhow, إِلَّا مَنْ سَفِيَ نَفْسَهُ, except for the one who's fooling himself. وَلَقَدْ اصْطَفَيْنَاهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا. And we, Allah says himself, we had already, and for sure it is we who had chosen him, we had chosen him. And the word istifa is also important here, because there are several words in Arabic used for making a choice. In the Quran we find ijtiba, we find ikhtiyar, we find istifa, we find different words for making a choice. The word istifa specifically highlights when a choice is made based on two things. One, purity. One, it's made on, based on purity. In other words, when you have a bunch of options in front of you and you choose the purest of those options, the thing that has the purest ingredients, that would be called istifa, because it comes from safu, which in itself means purity. But the other implication of istifa linguistically is also very powerful. And that is when a choice is made that is entirely your own and has no external influences. Meaning it's a choice in which you didn't take suggestions from anyone, you didn't consider anything, except the only reason you picked it is because it's your choice. I know I've talked about this in other durus when I've given dars on Surah Al-Hajj, but just to make that point clear to you, if you go to the store over here, the bookstore, they sell candy too, right? So you see a bunch of candies there and you pick up like a Twix. And your wife says, why didn't you get the M&M? Or the Snickers, or this or that. You like, why'd you get Twix? Well, what's your reason? I like it, that's it. It's my choice. That's it. There's no other factor involved. That would be istifa. That would be istifa, right? If you get the M&M because you figure it's the most for my money, I can share it, give it to the kid, it'll last longer, etc. Now there's ijtiba involved, there's other factors that you tried to reason and you made a decision based on some other qualifications. But istifa is a choice purely your own. Now the word is important because this surah, and as it's going to come also, the qibla will be changed by Allah Azza wa Jal. Whose decision is that? It's purely His. And Bani Israel is listening right now, and they believe in the choosing of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and they acknowledge that that choice was made purely by Allah Azza wa Jal. But they're having a hard time accept that the final messenger was also chosen purely by Allah. So the word of pure choice referring to Allah is highlighting a point about how messengers are chosen. You can't come up with a formula and say, that's why he was chosen. No, no, no. It's Allah's purely His choice. The only two things we know is He chooses the purest option. And second, purely it's His choice. You can't involve your logic and reasoning into it. You can't apply any of that into it. And this we find in two other places, or other places in Quran. For example, the Quraysh raised the criticism, how come no celebrity from the town? You know, رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. How come this Quran didn't come on one of the two great celebrities, or celebrities from two of the great towns? You know, the bigger families and the higher ups, if it came on them and they became a messenger, well, they're already millionaires, so we're ready to listen to them anyway, it would be easier. Why would we listen to this guy who's an orphan? And he's not really that high up in the ranks, politically speaking and economically speaking. So why should we listen to him? I mean, there were so many better choices available. That criticism they made. Bani Israel made the criticism, well, how come this messenger? What, there was a shortage among us? We're the chosen people. And how come Jibreel? We don't really like him that much. Remember that conversation before? So the word istifa here highlights, going back to the common point, and that's important too, that Ibrahim alayhi salam is the common thread between Bani Israel and Bani Ismail. He's the common link between them. And so when he builds the house of Allah, which is going to come, when he builds that house, and he was making that dua as he was building the foundations of the house, Bani Israel is being told, well, that house is also part of your legacy. It's not like you're abandoning your legacy to come to this one. Al-Masjid al-Aqsa is part of your legacy, yes. But even before Al-Masjid al-Aqsa, this is part of your legacy because this was built by Ibrahim alayhi salam. You know, it was the house of worship established by the one that even goes further back in your own lineage. So anyhow, وَلَقَدِ اصْطَفَيْنَاهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَإِنَّهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ لَمِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And certainly in the afterlife he is among the righteous. He will be among the righteous. May Allah make this from them. Make us all from them. And here again a clue. You better become of the righteous if you want to consider yourself part of the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Because they claim that. Both Jews and Christians claimed that they are a part of the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And Allah says, well, you want to be with him in the akhirah. The only people he'll stand with are the righteous. إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ. And so Allah is dropping a clue about Islam itself. Whenever his master said to him, submit, be Muslim is aslim. Actually, after Islam, the verb itself became the meaning of he became a Muslim. So when you say about somebody, aslama, you know, aslama means he became Muslim. It doesn't even mean he submitted anymore. It just means he became Muslim. And that's how it's even used in a hadith of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyhow, whenever Allah says to him, submit, qala aslamtu li rabbil alameen. He says, and there's no harf ataf here. Like, إِذْ قَالَ لَهُ رَبُّهُ أَسْلِمْ فَا ثُمَّ. There's no ataf here. قَالَ أَسْلَمْتُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. He said, I give myself up. I've submitted myself before the Lord, before the Master of the world. Now, there's something subtle and beautiful about this language. So I'll stop here before, because the next ayah is pretty deep also. But just share some highlights with you. The first thing is, he said, أَسْلَمْتُ. He used the past tense. He doesn't say, أُسْلِمُ. I submit, meaning I submit in Arabic, the present tense has the implication of meaning the present and the future. That might imply procrastination. I'll submit, yes. There may be lag. Aslamtu, there's no lag. It's immediate because it's already happened. It's as good as already done. So you know how when you have a really eager employee and you say to them, make sure you send that email, and they say, even before they do it, they're right about it, they say, done. Done. Like, you know, it's finished. It's this immediate response by Ibrahim alayhi salam. Aslamtu li rabbil alameen. And he acknowledges, when he submits, he acknowledges his reasons for submitting too. He could have said, aslamtu laka, aslamtu lillahi. But he makes sure he reminds himself, and through that reminder, he's reminding us, li rabbil alameen, to the master. I submit myself to the master. He's reminding himself of his slavery and Allah's mastery. The master of al-alameen, all nations and all peoples. And even in the word al-alameen, there's something beautiful. Because inside al-alameen is all nations. And Ibrahim alayhi salam, as far as the context of Arabia is concerned, the different nations, different religions that are in Arabia, they somehow all trace themselves back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. So they may look like different nations at that time. There's Christians, there's Jews, there's the Mushrikun. But actually all three of them somehow trace themselves back to Ibrahim alayhi salam. He says, Aslamtu li Rabbil Alameen. You know, he's calling, it's like there's a call being made in the statement of Ibrahim alayhi salam, how Allah quotes it, to this unified origin, which is again the house of Allah azza wa jal that was built. I'll at least mention the next ayah and I'll close. I won't explain it much. وَوَصَّى بِهَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ بَنِيهِ وَيَعْقُوبُ. And Ibrahim alayhi salam left a legacy, left a will, you could even say, for his sons. As did Yaqub. وَيَعْقُوب, and Yaqub did the same. How much time between Ibrahim alayhi salam and Yaqub alayhi salam? Who's in between? There's Ibrahim alayhi salam, then there's his son, Ishaq alayhi salam, and then there is Yaqub alayhi salam. So Allah is talking about the grandfather and the grandson. Now if you look at the dua of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Allah said, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً. From our children, at least give us a Muslim ummah. So in the next ayah, Allah is saying, actually, I've also fulfilled the dua, not only with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also in the next generation of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam, Yaqub alayhi wa sallam also fulfilled that legacy and traced himself back to exactly the words that his grandfather once said to his children. The grandson is saying those same words to his children. So it's something you're supposed to pass down to your children. And that would be part of the legacy of Ibrahim alayhi wa sallam. You know, the previous ayah said, who would turn away from his legacy except a fool? Well, Yaqub alayhi salam held on to that legacy, and one of the ways in which he held on to that legacy is giving his sons the same exact advice that his father once gave to his sons. Now what's that advice? Ya baniya inna Allah astafa lakum ad-deena. My sons, my beloved sons, Allah, no doubt about it is He who has chosen this deen for you. Once again, istifa. I won't explain what that means again. He has chosen that deen for you. Now there's istafa alaykum and istafa lakum. When it's something is a burden on you, alaykum is used. When something is a favor to you, lakum is used. Istafa lakum ad-deen. This religion has been chosen for you. The deen has been chosen for you, as a favor to you, as a gift for you. Lakum ad-deen. It's amazing that these prepositions, how they're used in Quran. Like in Surah At-Tawbah, Allah says, قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا. Tell them, nothing will afflict us except what Allah has written, not upon us, but for us. كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا, not عَلَيْنَا. عَلَيْنَا would mean we're going to come, you know, this was the Munafiqun talking about Muslims getting in trouble on the battlefield in Hunayn. Right? Muslims got in trouble in the battlefield in Hunayn. Allah told them to say, no, Allah, nothing will afflict us except what Allah has written for us, not against us, for us. Even in the toughest times, whatever we're going through, we know Allah has something good in it for us. كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. What beautiful verbiage, you know. So now here we find, you know, لَكُمُ الدِّينَ فَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Don't you dare die except that you're Muslims. Don't you dare die except that you're Muslims. Now listen to this. Who are the sons of Yaqub alayhi salam? We know who the sons of Ibrahim alayhi salam are. Who are the sons of Yaqub alayhi salam? Who does that include? Yusuf alayhi salam. Includes Yusuf alayhi salam. Now you tell me. He gave this advice to his sons. And this is, by some scholars, this is towards the end of his life. Because he's leaving a will, so it implies this is towards the tail end of his life. We know that Yusuf alayhi salam had brothers who did some pretty messed up things. They did some pretty messed up things. It's not like they, like I give the example often, it's not like they, you know, they took the rear view mirror broken from the dad's car and brought it back and said, Dad, sorry, I took your car for a spin. And, you know, and he says, Sabrun Jameel. That's not what happened. They took a shirt, you know, riddled with false blood, and they took it to their father. And they forgot to rip it up too, so it, you could tell that's not how animals eat. They don't take the shirt off and then eat. And then, you know, so he knew they were lying about it too. So they did some pretty messed up stuff. The reason I'm bringing this up is that we're learning through this dua and this instruction. On the one hand, there's dua. Ibrahim alayhi salam already made dua, take care of my children. But that's not enough. He has to tell his kids to stay straight too. Don't you dare die except that you're Muslims. Remain in submission. He has to take care of both things. Dua alone is not enough. You have to do that, your part too. Then the dua has power. Then Allah gives barakah in that dua. The other thing here is, whose kids are these? We said Yaqub alayhi salam. Whose son is he? Who's Yaqub alayhi salam the son of? Ishaq alayhi salam. And he's the son of Ibrahim alayhi salam. So these guys, these brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam, Illa bin Yamin, except for bin Yamin, these are sons of a prophet, grandsons of a prophet, great grandsons of a prophet. And yet they still messed up pretty bad. You could say they come from a pretty good family. You could say that they come from a pretty decent family. You know, a lot of times nowadays when you try to give warnings about youth going astray, people say, no, 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 not my kids. We come from a good family. Now my kids, we have a, mashallah, our grandfather was a scholar and his father was a muhaddith and his scholar was the head of the tafsir department of our madrasa. And you know, our five generations of hafaz, we're solid. I mean, righteousness runs in our blood. It's genetic for us. You know, it doesn't, we don't have those problems. You must be talking about that guy's kids. My kids, no, we come from a good family. Our last name is Muhammad or Ahmad or Quraishi or Chaudhry or something. Therefore, it is, our children are incapable of messing up. Let me guarantee you guys something. None of us come from a purer family than the sons of Yaqub alayhi salam. Nobody does here. Nobody has that kind of lineage. Sons of a prophet, grandsons of a prophet, great grandsons of a prophet, and brothers with a prophet too. Right? I mean, they're just one after another. They're coming from this pure lineage. But genetics aren't enough to keep you righteous. It doesn't run in the blood. It's not necessarily the case. You know, the mushrikun of Makkah are also children of Ibrahim alayhi salam. The followers of Musa alayhi salam are also the children of Yaqub alayhi salam. And the hypocrites among them are also followers of Yaqub alayhi salam. You know, there's no guarantees. So we can't recline on our heritage and say that our children are going to be okay. That can't be the case. And the final quick reminder I want to give you through these ayat, this parenting issue, how much Allah has emphasized worrying about the future generation in these ayat. It's a really interesting transition in Baqarah. And you're about to see more of it. On the one hand, there is you worrying about the future. And also not being a fool and not worry about the future. That's what, on the one hand, that's what we're learning. On the other hand, you know what we're going to start learning now? There are people who look at their past and they take pride in their past, even if their past was wrong. And they don't want to change their ways because they say, our past is like this, that's our tradition, we're not going to budge. We take pride in who we are, right? So there's people who, there's two kinds of foolish behavior. There's one, you're not worried about your future, and two, you're reclining on your past, whether it was good or not. And we'll see both those kinds of mistakes, you know, outlined in these ayat. Did Yusuf alayhi salam, you have to ask yourself this final question, was Yaqub alayhi salam a good parent? Absolutely. Actually, in the Quran, if you study Yaqub alayhi salam, you'll find, if you're looking for model parenting in the Quran, there are very few passages that talk about good fathers, and Yaqub alayhi salam somehow ends up in them. You know, you have Luqman radiallahu anhu and his advice to his son, but you have Yaqub alayhi salam several times talking about his children, especially in Surah Yusuf here in Baqarah. So he's a model parent. Of course, he's a prophet, so he's a model in that sense too. And even worrying about his kids, Allah mentions him making dua, so he's clearly a model parent. But his son still messed up. What are we learning here? You can do your best with your children, and you have to. You don't have a choice. You have to do your best with your children. But in the end, they will make the decisions that they will make once they become adults. And once they become adults and they make the dumb decisions that they might make, because they are adults, you yelling and screaming will not make things better and turn them righteous all of a sudden. At that point, you need to take Yaqub alayhi salam's advice and say what? فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ. That's all he can do. I mean, I was expecting him to yell and scream when he brings back the shirt, but he knows these guys are at an age where yelling at them and going crazy at them is not going to work. That's their ship is sailed. I did what I could with them. I did what I could with them. But, you know, the rest I have to leave to Allah. So he reminds them. He gives them warning. He reminds them of Allah. Allahul Musta'an, ala ma tasifun. And he gives them his example. I'm going to have sabr. But he can't do much more. And that sabr and that dua, the sincere dua to Allah, years go by, but eventually those bad corrupt sons do make tawbah. They do come around. So those of you that are having trouble with your older kids, and you say, I've been making dua, nothing's happened. Right? Well, it takes a while. It takes a while. You have to have a lot of sabr. Now these are important lessons for parenting that Allah has embedded in these beautiful ayat. Inshallah, we'll talk more about this next ayah, this ayah itself, in our next gathering. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.